You that you're awake. I thank you, as read your in your word today in Psalm 121, that you never sleep or slumber. The God who watches Israel, Lord, you never take a nap. Lord, you're always watching over us. And I just thank you right now, Holy Spirit, for your power. I thank you, God, for your grace. And I need it tonight. And I just pray that this word that you put into my spirit, and I ask you that it would, every single word, Lord, that you want to speak would come out tonight. And God, that you would, I pray more than anything, you would empower us. I pray that we would be empowered. I pray against the enemy right now that he would not be able to condemn anyone by these words or bring any sense of shame. But I just pray for empowerment, power to get on the inside of us, God, that would change the course of our lives, that would change, God, the trajectory of where we think we're going, and it would just alter our course, God. Father, I just thank you for your presence that I feel right now. And I invite you, Holy Spirit. I pray for those who've never felt your presence before. Just like I remember when I was 16 and someone was praying at the front, and I would just feel just the wind of your spirit just blow over me, and I'd be like, God, you're real. Thank you, Lord, for you. I didn't know what to say. I just was feeling your presence, Lord. And I got to know you at a young age, and I pray, God, for every person under the sound of my voice, that they would know you today, that they would go deeper with you, that there would be a deeper surrender, a deeper consecration, a deeper set apartness. Amen. I feel like the Lord, at least temporarily, I'm not big into like, oh, we are like, let's call our youth ministry something. Okay, there's only 5 trillion youth ministries called Catalyst, or youth ministries called, like, name out some other ones, like, what are you?
I love my youth group.
Sorry. Is Catalyst a youth group in Sarnia?
No.
One in Toronto? There's a lot, like, if you like Catalyst Youth Group, 50,000 pages come up from youth groups all over the United States. Here's what I'm saying, Dalen. I'm not into just like, let's give our youth group a name. Like, to me, more important than like giving ourselves a name is loving people, right? Like, we want to get the heart of God before we're like, oh, let's call ourselves something. Let's get the DNA of Jesus. This is all, I just call our youth group Jesus people. Jesus freaks. Jesus culture, that would be a good one, it's taken. But really what we always want to do is we always want to go with the Holy Spirit. And I feel like the Lord has been speaking this actually 2:22 for ages and just for actually the last year and a bit. And actually the Lord actually told me, Mike, to call you today. And so I called you and I looked at my clock and guess what time it was? It was 2:22, and it was like, and you didn't pick up for like 4 or 5 rings, and so I'm like, is he gonna pick up when it's still 2:22? And then you picked up, and it was 2:22. I didn't say anything, and I'm like, hey, Mike, how's it going? And I just was like, I'm like, man. and we were talking for a bit, and then it was 2:23. But the point is, I'm like, man, God, you're always like, ever like God ever speaks to you through numbers before? Like, so many times, like, I've just driven to like the end of the street, and I didn't know why, and I just look up at this house at the end of the street, and it's like 2:22, and I'm like, God, you're talking to me. And it's actually happened a number of times in a number of ways where the Lord has, don't remember all the instances, but the Lord has just spoken. And I feel, and this has significance, because there's a scripture I'm going to read in just a moment that I feel that's so pertinent to our generation. You guys know what pertinent means? Pertinent means to the point. It's like right on the money of like what we need to hear. We live in a culture right now, guys, that is sexually charged. Charged. You can't hardly turn on TV and watch a Dove commercial without seeing like thigh and buns and, you know what I'm saying? Like tight Dove. And it's running down the woman's leg and it's like, oh, I don't need to see that. I'm like, I like Dove soap, but I don't need to see leg. So I don't watch TV because I can't handle it. It just puts imagery. Sometimes I'm like, I can't even like watch a basketball game because I see these cheerleaders wearing nothing. And I'm like, I'm glad you have, anyway, I can go, you know that's what I'm saying. Everything, and there's a motto in advertisement that's called sex sells. Has anyone ever heard that before? sex sells. And the sexier and the more sexually charged, risque, flirtatious, crude, perverted it gets, it seems the more that people, dudes and girls go after it. I mean, I can't even drive home from church on a Friday night and drive past, like everywhere I go now, especially in summer, I see these girls and I'm like, why are you wearing underwear? Or a little skirt that goes up to here. And sorry to say, I won't even say. We live in a sexually charged culture where young people are giving themselves away. Could you imagine, Mike, if you want to marry a young woman? No, I'm not saying a name. And you had in your heart, man, I'm gonna buy her a $10,000 ring. $10,000. And you worked, say you worked for an entire year, saved up every penny, and you got that ring and a big diamond. And she took it, and she was like, oh, thanks. And then one couple days later, you're walking along with that special someone, and she's like, you know what, I don't really like this, and she chucks it down the sewer.
Chill.
How would you feel about that? How would you feel about that?
I'd probably punch her.
One of the greatest gifts that we have as people from God. Now, this is why I pray that it wouldn't condemn you, because I believe the Lord can restore anything and do anything, and I've heard every story under the book of God. I'm telling you, if you give your broken pieces to God, He can restore them and make something beautiful out of any amount of brokenness. Yeah. His grace and mercy and forgiveness and redemptive power supersedes any amount of sin and any amount of junk that you've gotten yourself into and any amount of impurity. But I'm telling you, one of the most powerful things that you possess is your purity. See, you can't build your life in God without purity. Purity is the main thing. If there's something that launches you into destiny, if there's something that gives you the anointing of the Holy Spirit, the Bible, even Jesus even said, Blessed or happy are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. So only the pure in heart get to see God. Purity proceeds power. There's no other way to do it. There's no other way to build a conquering youth ministry that's going to reach nations without purity. I'm learning this in my life, Tim. I have a confession to make. Carly's not here. I might as well just. I used to preach stuff about don't kiss till you're married, and I actually felt in my and I was reading Wild at Heart and this stuff, and I felt like the Lord said I, and it might have been the Lord, it might have been me, I don't know, but I kissed. Carly and I kissed. Listen. No. I don't want you to clap. Was it all right? Yeah, it was nice. But I tell you what, listen, I'm not gonna get into it. I'm not gonna be like, oh, this is the. Listen, the reason that I preached that I thought that people shouldn't kiss until, and I did preach this at one point, and to tell you the truth, I'm coming back to it. We actually just made a commitment about 2 weeks ago that we were gonna save our next kiss on till our wedding day, which I don't know when it's gonna be. And I'll tell you why. I'll tell you why. This is a, I'm not putting legal, I'm not telling you guys. Listen, if that's what's in your heart, I encourage you with all my heart to do that. Because it's worth it. And I don't regret, because I feel it was kind of the Lord. And I mean, anyway, long story. Everyone has their own journey. But I went back there, and I'll tell you why. Because we started, it was just, it's, when you start kissing, talk about unsimmered. I mean, all engines go when you start kissing. It's just a fact. If you don't want it, if you think that you're turned on without kissing, start kissing, and it goes to a whole nother level quickly. Quickly. Like, not even, you guys with me? I would encourage you, really, if you have that in your heart, man, I just don't want to kiss until I'm married, or don't want to kiss until, you know, I just want to save that. I think that would be an amazing thing. And I talked to my pastor about it before I did it. I didn't like just go, oh, I think I'm going to do it. Like, this is something like Carly and I knew each other for, like, we had dated for like 8 months or whatever it was, and 6 months or so. I don't know what it was. No, it wasn't two. And so I had to retract and just be like, you know what, we need to go back to like holding hands. Because I can't do it. I'm a man of God, and I cannot kiss you and be okay. I get too whacked out. You guys know what I mean? It's just like, I can't do it. As godly a man as I am, and if anybody here knows me, you know that I'm a man of God. Yeah. Keep my word. I don't lie, I don't cheat, I always tell the truth, I'm always upright, I always am honest, and I'm a man of God, and that's who I am. But when it comes to that type of thing, I've actually had to step back and say, I can't do it. And I'm 28 years old, and I've kept myself pure since I got born again when I was 16. But I haven't done anything. The only thing I've done is kiss a girl. I've had two girlfriends in 12 years, one girl from some other country, Colombia, and then Carly, and that's it. And if I kept kissing Carly, it wouldn't be good. Because I'm a man, just like there's men in here, and because when we had to retire. Are you guys okay with that? I'm kind of opening up my heart, my life a little bit to you guys. But all that to say, if that's what's in your heart, Bree, I encourage you to do it. If that's what's in your heart to save that, I encourage you to do it. If not, then let's talk, and I think there's I'm just telling you, it gets pretty crazy pretty quickly. I want to read a few scriptures, and then I want to talk about what 222 means. You guys ready?
Yeah.
Go to the next slide. This is Paul. He's actually writing his very last letter that he wrote in the entire Bible. He was actually in prison when he wrote this. He was in prison for preaching the gospel. They threw him in prison, and somehow he wrote a letter to his spiritual son, Timothy, who was probably in his 30s or 40s at this point, pastoring a church of thousands and thousands of people in Ephesus. And so he wrote in chapter 2, I wish we could read all of chapter 1, but for time's sake, he says, "You therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus." Everyone say that. Say grace.
Grace.
Listen, grace. Whew. I love talking about grace. Grace is where God's power is. If you want to tap into God's power, you got to tap into His grace. Grace gives you, everyone look this way, grace gives you the power to be godly. Grace actually came into my life, Julie, when I was 16, and changed my desires. Before I knew Jesus, I was just like every other 16-year-old boy. I was a pervert. I know how boys think. Especially you've got boys that don't know Jesus. Even some boys that know Jesus, 16-year-old boys. I'm 16, I'm a man. No, you're not. You're still a boy. I'm not calling you a pervert, but I'm just saying, some Christian young men are perverts still. And you need to tap into God's grace. I'm just saying. But I got changed. God changed me, and where I was lusting, that lust started to leave. God changed my heart. You guys know what I'm talking about? When the Holy Spirit comes in and he starts to mess with stuff on the inside, and you're like, I used to want to do this, and now I don't want to do it anymore. I just want to love Jesus and be pure and worship and read my Bible and tell people and just hug people. And just this love of God started consuming me. But I tell you, it came with a cost. Look at what he says. And the things that you've heard from me among many witnesses, commit these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. And that's the purpose of church to me. I'm like, I want to pour into you guys something that you can take out and tell someone else and empower someone else and encourage someone else. And this is what this is all about. I want to transmit to you and give you something that you can tell someone else that will empower them. And that's what church is about to me. You therefore must endure, so be strong in the grace. Share this with faithful men. You therefore must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No one engaged in warfare entangles himself in the affairs of this life that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. It's been my experience that very quickly after I got saved, I realized I wasn't on a cruise ship. I was on a battleship. And if I wanted to succeed in this life with God, in this life with Christ, I had to start to learn how to humble myself before the Lord. Carla, I had to start to learn how to obey orders. Jesus would tell me to do stuff. Jesus would tell me not to do stuff. Jesus would speak to me through my pastor. Jesus would speak to me through my Bible a lot. Jesus, and every time, I remember shortly after I got saved, I started to veer off the road, and the enemy just got right a hold of me again, and I never did drugs or anything like that again, but I started getting prideful, and you guys have heard this story before, a lot of you, and you know, then I went to a revival and got back on track, and I've been on track for 11 and a half years, and it's been awesome. I'm telling you guys, you're not just going to float on by. I mean, there's an enemy. Who do you think empowers pop culture? You think it's just, you think people want to do some of the stuff that they do? You think a girl, a young woman, made in God's image, thinks to herself when she's 14, man, I sure would like to grow up and become a porn actress when I grow up. That's the devil. We're at war. Like, this isn't like Christian, you know what I mean? This isn't like, we don't live in a Christian, but we walk outside and we need to be alert. The Bible says, be sober, be vigilant. Do you know what vigilant means, Justin? It means alert, awake, poised for action. It means ready. Be sober, be vigilant, for your adversary, the devil, roams around like a lion, seeking whom he may devour. Do you know that the enemy is trying to devour you, Julie? I gotta tell you the truth. He is after you. I don't like to talk about the devil. I like to talk about Jesus, but I have to because I see too many young adults getting picked off because they don't know. They think it's just them. They think some of the stuff that they're facing is them. It's actually an attack of the enemy. We're at war. Do you guys realize that? Just nod at me. We are at war. And I'll tell you where the main enemy attack is on your life as a young person. It's against your purity. It's against your purity. Because he knows if he can grab hold of that, like I'm talking about grab hold of it, if he can grab hold of your emotions and your heart. See, purity starts in the heart. Purity really starts in the heart. It starts in the mind. People say like the greatest sexual organ you have is actually your brain. It's true. Because everything, it's all up there. That's where it starts. That's where it formulates. That before you act anything out, you think it. So if you can guard it up here, guard your thoughts and guard your mind, you can win the battle. And that's another message. But go to the next slide. Actually, go back for a second. Purity is the key to victory. If you're saying, God, I want victory in my life. The key to victory is purity. What's the key to purity? It's the Holy Spirit. It's hanging out with God. God's grace that gets in there and changes you. Let's go to the next slide. I want to get into this. Remind them of this. I'm flipping all the way to verse 14 for sake of time. Remind them of these things, charging them before the Lord not to strive about words to no profit, the root to the ruin of their ears. Be diligent to present yourself approved to God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. It's one of my prayers. God, I want to be approved by you, a worker who does not need to be ashamed. Rightly dividing your word, preaching your word, the gospel of Jesus right down the middle. Verse 60, but shun profane and idle babblings, for they will increase to more ungodliness. Next slide there. Verse 22 says, flipping down to there, it says, flee also youthful lusts, but pursue righteousness, faith, love, peace with those who call on the Lord. It should say out. Change that, Josh, you will. Out of a pure heart. Flee also youthful lusts, but pursue righteousness, faith, love, peace with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. I believe that God's grace comes and empowers you to do His word. Here's what I don't believe God's grace empowers you to do. I do not believe that God's grace empowers you to face temptation and conquer it. There's nowhere in the Bible that says God's grace will cause you to overcome temptation. You know what God's grace will cause you to do? It will cause you to run. Flee. The Bible says flee temptation. Run from it. See, this is the key. If you want to beat the devil every single time, this is what you do. You don't even get in the ring. You don't even go there. Don't even fight him. Nowhere in the Bible does it tell you to fight the devil. What it tells you to do is fight the good fight of faith. That fight of faith is to hear the voice of God and obey it. Flee youthful lust. I believe that. See, so many times we're asking for grace to overcome certain things that God is saying, just get it out of your life. Yeah. If you got it out of your life, you wouldn't have to overcome it. If you just ran, then you wouldn't have to do, it wouldn't even be a struggle. Lord, please help me overcome lust. And we're sitting there watching HBO. Or much music. I remember one time as a 19-year-old, I sat there and I was watching, Lord, I just want to get a pulse for what my generation is going through. So I was sitting there watching 50 Cent, something, something. Didn't like it. I'm just like, our generation's looking at this. Before I knew it, I was getting attacked by lust. It's like trying to sit in a pile of manure, just lazy boy style, and not stink like manure. Of course you're going to stink like manure if you sit in manure. Of course you're going to get attacked by lust if you open up your heart to it. I remember a story that Joyce Meyer told. Anyone know who Joyce Meyer is? She told a story one time, and her kids came up to her, and they said, "Mom, Mom, we want to watch this movie." And she looked at the movie, and it was rated like PG or something, maybe PG-13. She said, "No, we can't watch that movie because it has this and this." "Oh, Mom, come on." "No." "Mom, come on." "No, we're not watching that movie." So Joyce actually made the kids later that afternoon or the next day or something some brownies, and she actually put just a little, went outside, got a little dog turd, mixed it in with the brownie mix.
That's a radical mom right there.
Mixed it right in, put the brownies, baked them. "Hey kids, brownies, yay, brownies." "Oh, there's something you need to know though, my children. I put a little dog turd in those brownies. No big deal, you won't even taste it." "Oh, Mom, that's disgusting." "Oh, don't worry, you won't even taste it. Maybe if you get a chunk or something, you might taste like a little tiny thing, but don't worry about it, just a little tiny piece. Come on, eat it." "No, that's disgusting." You know what she said? "Listen, if you won't put a little bit of dog turd in your physical body, that's gonna perish in X number of years, why would you put spiritual darkness and spiritual dog turds and spiritual junk in your eternal soul?" That's a pretty good question. If you wouldn't put a little, I'm actually working out a lot, and I'm staying away from the chips, and I'm staying away from stuff, and I'm actually feeling pretty good. But I'm telling you, I would never eat a dog turd. For $2 million, I would do it. I stand corrected. I would chomp that thing for $100,000, my friend. But listen.
Does it matter? Just
try to pay me $2 million to watch a porno video. Won't do it. I won't do it. There's no amount of money, nothing that you could give me to get me to sit down for 10 seconds and watch some porn. I care about my heart more than anything, any amount of money. The most valuable thing to me is my heart. Yeah. Your spirit is more valuable than all the money in the world. No. 4 million. 7 billion won't do it. I've had to walk, I remember being in high school, I've had to walk out of classes. I remember Judah Smith told a story one time and provoked me. He walked in, he said, they were watching some video in some class, English class or something. He said, "Sorry, Mrs. Whoever, I can't watch this video." And she said, "Well, if you're not gonna watch the video, you need to go stand outside in the hall." He said, "Okay." She said, "No, I want you, if you don't watch this video, you fail." And he looked at her and said, "I'm a man of God, I failed that. I won't watch that video." Questionable scenes, different things that, listen, do you wonder why you struggle so much? And do you wonder why this youth ministry, now this is, look around guys, this is the biggest youth ministry in Sarnia. 73,000 people. Do you wonder why we're struggling to grow? It's because we're compromising with the enemy's stuff. We're filling our hearts with junk and then saying, "God, why aren't I walking in the victory? I really want your presence in my life." Yet we're sleeping around with the enemy, or at least flirting with him. And God's like, "I want to fill you with my spirit. I want to touch you. I want to empower you." But only those who have been purified by the Holy Spirit. And that's a process called sanctification. When I've fallen into something, sometimes there's a little bit of a process, a couple days. Sometimes it's just a few hours where I just can even sense the Lord again. Not because he's not there, it's just because I've... Okay. I want to read this verse in a couple... I'm almost done. You guys with me?
Yeah.
I believe that we're supposed to call this ministry 222. And I believe that we're supposed to be a youth ministry, a youth and young adult ministry that stands for righteousness in our generation.
Yeah.
I believe that we're called to be a youth ministry that says yes to God in every way, in every form, every day. Passionately pursuing His presence. Passionately pursuing His voice. Passionately desiring to walk in a demonstration of His power. But the only way we walk in His power is if our hearts are confident before Him. And if there's a pure flow of His grace and fire and love that can flow through us. Because we've cleansed ourselves of all that junk and we don't walk in it anymore. Because we're the people of God. We're the people of God. Are we the people of God?
Yeah.
Put up your hand if you belong to God.
Oh, you.
I belong to God. Thank you, Lord. You can put down there. There's, in 2 Timothy, read before that, I actually didn't read, I didn't put that in there, but it says in verse 19, just before verse 22, it says, "Nevertheless, the solid foundation of God stands, having this seal, the Lord knows those who are His, and let everyone who names the name of Christ depart from iniquity." In other words, if you name the name of Jesus, you walk away from all sin. Let everyone who belongs to Him walk away from everything else. Take the world, but give me Jesus. Now that Matt Redman song is, I'm going to read this in a few other versions, but that Matt Redman song is so awesome. Take the world, but give me Jesus. He sings, "I've thrown it all away, that I might gain a life in You. I found all else is loss compared to the joys of knowing You. Your beauty and Your majesty is far beyond compare. You've won my heart, now this will be my prayer. Take the world, but give me Jesus, Your treasure in this life. Take the world, but give me Jesus is my cry. Now I've found You as a Savior, I will leave the rest behind. Take the world, but give me Jesus is my cry." I think that needs to be our cry. Paul said, "I found all things lost compared to the unsurpassable knowledge of knowing Jesus." Next. NIV says, we just read the New King James Version, it says, "Flee the evil desires of youth." Listen, don't overcome them by His grace. His grace will say, run. And if it's not saying run, it's not His grace. Because it would be against His word. You guys with me? And pursue. I gotta get that. I have it in the Greek in a minute. Pursue righteousness. It means chase after, as if to apprehend. It means go after righteousness, faith, love, and peace, along with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. You know what that says to me? It says church. It says getting with the body of Christ. Get with those who are calling on the Lord out of a pure heart. All right, I'm losing some of you. Quickly. Next one there. NLT says, New Living Translation, which a lot of the Bibles we give away, it says, run from anything that stimulates youthful lusts. Instead, pursue righteous living. You know, that's why I stopped kissing Carly. Thank you. That's why I stopped, because you know why? Because I was getting too stimulated. I don't know how to say it. When I get married, I'm going to have sex. All the time. But until then, listen, for real. Until then, I can't be stimulated by youthful lusts. Forbidden fruit. You know why? Because if I was and if I fell, I wouldn't be up here preaching, and we'd probably shut down this youth ministry and Dunamis Church. Micah would take over, he says. He's the emblem of purity. He's an awesome man. You guys would lose. You'd lose something. I tell you guys, and Carla knows what I'm talking about. Carla, I'm 28, Carla's 30, we're the two oldest people, except John.
John's 18.
John's 18, yeah. I gotta hurry. I have never seen a minister who ministers in power and has influence fall into sin, sexual sin, immorality, and come back stronger. Never. Not in the Bible, not in life. It doesn't happen. David, read the story. David didn't come back stronger, my friend. In fact, he had everything. And once he did that, the Lord said, war is going to pursue your house, you're going to lose your kingdom. Now that sucks. All because of... Read the story, 2 Samuel 11, 12, 13. It's such a sad story. God still loved him, he repented, and God restored a little bit. He was still a man after God's own heart, but he lost a lot. I'm telling you, this is the truth. Enjoy the companionship of those who call on the Lord out of pure hearts. Next one. English Standard Version, so flee youthful passions and pursue righteousness, faith, along with those who call on the Lord. Next one. Stay away from the lusts which tempt young people. Pursue what God has. Pursue what has God's approval. Pursue faith, love, and peace together with those who worship the Lord with a pure heart. Next. Run away from infantile indulgence. Run after mature righteousness, faith, love, peace, joining those who are in honest and serious prayer before God. Next one. This is the last one here in the Amplified. Shun youthful lust and flee from them, and aim at and pursue righteousness, all that is virtuous and good, right living, conformity to the will of God in thought, word, and deed, and aim at and pursue faith, love, and peace, harmony, and concord with others, in fellowship with all Christians who call upon the Lord out of a pure heart. Next. Very quickly, flee in the Greek. It means to flee away, to seek safety. It means to flee or shun or avoid by flight something abhorrent. It means to escape safely out of danger. If I could communicate in a moment how solemn this message is, how serious it is. If you could gain some kind of scope of vision over the next 50 years of your life and see how one night or one week of pleasure would ultimately redirect the course of your entire life if you didn't repent. You would probably be on your knees weeping before God, asking him for his grace and his wisdom to never make that mistake. I'm telling you, You do not want to go through the pain of a divorce. You do not want to go. And I'm this man of God that's decided to give my life to Him. Oh, Mike, you've been talking the whole time, bro. If you really need to talk, just thank you, sir. Love you. If you like, I'm so intense about this because God is showing me the key to how to win a city. Look, everyone, look this way. I know that I'm preaching a long time. This is the key. It's the Holy Spirit, but it's running from anything that's not of God and pursuing God. It's being the light. It's being different. Not high and mighty, oh, Christian, and you're of the world, and I'm not going to talk to you. Not that. Because when you really get the Holy Spirit, when you really get His love, all you think about is, man, I just have compassion on everyone. I just want people to know my Jesus. Because He loves me. He's changed me. You just start to love people that are in darkness, and you want to go into their world and just take them out. You don't want to go in and indulge with them. Next one there. Youthful just means young. Next one. Lust means desire, craving, longing, desire for what is forbidden. And that's really what lust is. It's just a desire for what you can't have right now. And when you indulge in it, can I be super honest with you guys just for one more moment? I'm like, Carly, hot. And so I need to like stay away. I need to limit my time. So one thing I've understood is we don't hang out after 12 anymore. Because I realized if I'm not going to kiss her, one of the keys is I'm not going to hang out after 12. Because God's telling me at 11:30 not to kiss her, and at 12:30 He's telling me to kiss her. You guys know what I'm saying? The Lord's like, don't do it. An hour goes by and I just feel like, oh, I feel like the Lord is saying that we can just, one more, you know? No! That's not the Lord! It's your lust! It's your natural inclination, bodily function to have sex. It's your hormones. They speak loud, especially when they get stimulated. It's like your hormones are like this UFC fighter that's just chilling on the lazy boy, just eating chips, you know, and watching, I don't know, Jeopardy. And then when you, I mean, hanging out with, he starts to get ready. I mean, by the time like he's ready to go, go to the next thing. I don't know what I'm talking about right now. 222, this is what I feel. 222, the young adult ministry of Dunamis Church. I feel like God wants to put something inside of you today that says, God, I want to go after you with all my heart. I know I'm preaching long, but I want to release a spirit today. I want to release an anointing today that we would be young people that go after God. There's grace to run and pursue. Run from sin, pursue God. Don't run through sin, run from it. You'll win every time. I have one more thing I wrote there. I just want to read it, and we're done. This is what we're closing with tonight.
Oh, my God.
I wrote it. Don't worry, I wrote it. I'm just going to read it. I'm dreaming of an overcoming church. I'm dreaming of a local church that burns with love and passion for Jesus in an ever brighter, ever greater expression of that love in worship, in service, in loving the world around us. A church that is growing in passion, in purity, in creative evangelism, And in a church that holds the fundamental truth of the preaching of the gospel, of maintaining and growing in Christian discipline. A church that sees the lost saved daily. Oh, I'm dreaming of that church. Yeah. Hallelujah. God, I'm praying for that church. The book of Acts. A church that sees the lost saved daily. Broken marriages restored. Families brought together, back together, financial bondage broken and the sick healed. A church that disciples nations. This is my idea of church, the way God means it to be. This is Dunamis Church. This is a powerful church, the way God meant it to be. So I'm dreaming of, Carla. We're going after this thing. Are you guys with me?
Yeah.
All right, I just want to pray. Stand to your feet right now. People in here that need Jesus, I'm not going to ask you to put up your hands or anything. I'm just going to pray this prayer. This is a salvation prayer. And if you want to pray it along, I'll just get everyone to say it. It might not be true for you in this moment, but at one moment you were true, but just support those. There's a number of people. Just say this, Lord Jesus, I come to you, and I just confess I'm a sinner. I need you. Come into my life. Be the Lord of my life. Save me. I receive your grace. Change me on the inside. I want to follow you, Jesus. Now, if you prayed that prayer and you really want to follow Jesus, the next step for you is to get baptized into Christ Jesus. Baptism and salvation are one and the same thing. If you're saved, get baptized. We had a number of baptisms. Katie and a number of other people got baptized. Mark Fossey, Holy Smokes, got baptized. It's really one of the same things. The Bible says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, repent, be baptized, and you will be saved. We're doing a baptism service this Friday again. And there's one or two more people at least that want to get baptized. If you want to do that, you can talk to me. And I want to encourage you in your cell group. We're going to break into cells in just a moment. And I would encourage you to talk to your cell leader. Talk to your cell leader about if you made a decision for Jesus tonight and you want to really get to know me, I want to give you a Bible and help you. All right, I want to pray for this anointing to get all over us tonight. Oh, offering. Okay, we'll do it after this prayer. I want to pray for this anointing to get all over us tonight. So if what I said in my tired state, thank you for your anointing. I think getting up at 5 o'clock to pray for hours today worked because I felt the Lord tonight. So just lift up your hands just for a moment. Lord, purify our hands and purify our hearts. Your word says, who may ascend the hill of the Lord? He who has clean hands and pure hearts. Purify us, Holy Spirit, and give us wisdom. Beyond all things, Lord, I pray with all my heart right now for wisdom on these young adults, wisdom on these young people. Just lift your hands right up to heaven. Wisdom in Jesus' name. Grab hold of it. Just take it. Just say, I take wisdom. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Holy Spirit, come. Amen.